Life in America in the South for African Americans after the abolition of slavery was improved, but was still a world filled with oppression and hardship.
By 1860, free African American men participated in at least 65 different job types, ranging from carpenters to shoemakers to tailors. Despite the progress these people were making, the city council attempted to limit the wages an African American could earn to no more than a dollar a day. The African Americans who were able to rise up and enter the so-called black elite replicated the behavior of their white counterparts. The black elite attempted to distance themselves from the average African American who was often propertyless, living in poverty, and working under terrible conditions similar to those slaves experienced. Although examples of successful African Americans are not prevalent during this time period, persistence and luck helped some people overcome the barriers instilled by the racist society they were released into after their emancipation.
The United States government's first attempt to promote racial equality was the passing of the Civil Rights Act of 1866. This act stated that all citizens, defined as people born in the United States, regardless of race or color, are to be treated equally and granted equal rights in the eye of the law. However, little was done to enforce this act, and people of color continue to be discriminated against. Seeing such, the government passed another Civil Rights Act in 1875. This time making compulsory the inclusion of people of color on juries, previously all white, and ensuring equal service to all peoples, regardless of race or color. But eventually, advancements towards equality in the 19th century came to a halt in 1877, when the Republican government capitulated to the Democratic Party in the South.
In 1865, the economic shift from slavery led to the productivity of the South to drop dramatically. In 1880, freed slaves were putting in about a fifth the amount of work before, and the output of cotton, which was one of the most important crops in the South, per person fell from $147.98 as a slave to $74.03 as a sharecropper. This was beneficial in terms of the well-being of African Americans, but the economy of the South took a hit. In 1865, with the abolition of slavery, African Americans needed to work, and sharecropping became one of the main livelihoods taken on by newly freed slaves. Sharecropping was when a family or individual farmed a piece of land that was not their own, and part of their crop was given to the owner of the land. A common sharecropping farm owned by an African American was between 20 to 50 acres, which was a third of the size of the average farm operated by a white farmer. While African Americans strived to own their own land, racism blocked their path. In many cases, whites would not sell land to African Americans even if they could pay. Sharecropping was so oppressive and central to the Southern way of life that even in 1965, when Dr. King visited a plantation in Mississippi, he was shocked to find sharecroppers that had never seen U.S. currency.
Though all African Americans faced myriad of obstacles post-emancipation, African American women faced very gender-specific struggles. Initially, many African American women saw independence as an opportunity to finally devote more time and effort toward their families. As white women were free to be homemakers, many African American women hoped for the same opportunities. However, in the South, many white citizens were unhappy with the lack of low-leveled workers available for hire, as so many freed women now chose to stay home. In response, policies in the South often held African American women accountable for female loaferism and forced them to enter into working contracts. The ones who re-entered the workforce stuck mainly to domestic jobs like cooking, washing, ironing, weaving, and feeding the livestock. Some masters even forced women still to work in the fields as needed. Overall, African American women's jobs were practically just as limited as they were when they were slaves. Fortunately, they did see some improvements, albeit small, such as being allowed to plant their own crops to sell for profit and being given half a day off to wash their family's clothing. Though these improvements are minuscule, they are important and speak to African American women's dedication to supporting their families.
With the enactment of the Black Codes in 1865, which were created to oppress the new sense of freedom African Americans felt, the percentage of African Americans in prisons became larger than the white population. Convict leasing came to be a substitute for slavery. In 1878, Georgia leased out 1,239 prisoners, and all but 115 were African American. The most brutal form of prison labor enacted upon these men were chain gangs. Chain gangs began in the early 1890s as part of a massive road project. Robert Burns, a former member of a chain gang, stated, The chains the prisoners wore were permanently riveted on them, worked in them, slept in them, were part of them, to the same level just animals, and treated worse than animals. Members of chain gangs were treated like animals and were thrown back into the horrors of slavery. The nation finally took action, chain gangs were abolished in every state by the 1950s. But African American farmers pushed through hardship and oppression and clearly made strides in the right direction. In 1875, African Americans owned roughly 3 million acres of land, while in 1890, 8 million, and finally in 1900, 12 million acres. Through their perseverance and drive, African Americans were able to acquire land of their own and move against a system that was trying to make them fail. African Americans also pushed back through the formation of unions. One example was the CFNACU, the Colored Farmers National Alliance and Cooperative Union, in 1891. Violence was employed by whites to counteract this forward movement of African Americans and keep them oppressed. The Freedmen's Bureau, which was founded by Congress in 1865, tried to help, but in reality failed. Lynching and violent alterations continued to cause terror, so people decided to move. They moved around the country from the west to Kansas, or later on in the early 20th century to the north. Thank you.